Hi, my name's Deb Keener, and I am one of the founders of the Potter's Hands Foundation, which is an organization to really fight the battle of sex trafficking. And our goal is to open up a safe house for minors who've been trafficked in the Western New York region. Many people don't realize that there's actually a problem with minor domestic sex trafficking in the United States. However, I actually became aware of the problem after my daughter-in-law took a trip to India a few years ago. And she came back and talked about sex trafficking in India, which I knew was a problem there. I knew it was a problem in Thailand and Cambodia. I had no idea that we had a problem in Western New York. So I began researching sex trafficking, and as soon as I did, I really learned that we have a problem here in the United States, much bigger than most people realize. We have such a huge need for something to be done for these minors who've been trafficked. Most of these girls enter into trafficking between the ages of 12 and 14, and a lot of them come out of the foster care system. It's estimated that about 75% of the girls come through the foster care system and end up on the streets with a pimp who's controlling their lives. When I first became involved in this, one of the things that I wanted to do was meet with Elizabeth Files, who was at that time the Western New York, the head of Human Trafficking Task Force for Western New York. And my husband and I went up to Hamburg, New York to meet with her. And while we were there, she was so helpful just giving us information, because when I first heard about this, I was like, really, is there a problem really in Western New York? And so I wanted to talk to somebody who really knew something about it. So we traveled to Hamburg to meet with her, and I was so shocked when she told me that there were only 117 beds in all of the United States for minor victims of sex trafficking. In the month of July this year, just in July, there were 168 girls rescued across the United States. 112 of those girls were never reported missing by anyone. And so, you know, as we look at what is really going on in our country, a lot of people still believe it's not happening in their community. And one of the things that Elizabeth shared with us is it absolutely is happening in every community. The problem is that the media doesn't necessarily always recognize it as human trafficking, and neither do the courts at this point. We're moving in the right direction with that, but the court systems right now will often show an arrest that's been made, or they will report things out on the news as, you know, someone being arrested for child pornography. We don't necessarily recognize it as the crime of sex trafficking because it's not portrayed that way, but it truly is sex trafficking. Anytime someone is forced, coerced in any way, a girl doesn't even have to leave her own home to be sex trafficked. It could be a stepfather paying her for favors, sexual favors, and that is, under the law, considered sex trafficking. The house will be over here, looking out into those woods, and then the driveway will come up just down that way a little bit. We'll actually have 12 girls in the home when we're at full capacity, with 3 to 4 full-time staff living in the house. The design of the home is incredible. We've been blessed with the most incredible builder. I just have to share that story with you real quick. So our builder, I have this list called the action list that I put names on whenever God gives me these names of people or whatever, different ideas. So it's like this incredible list. And so I put his name on my list back in June of 2013, never really knowing why I had his name on the list, other than the fact that I knew he was a Christian, I knew he was a builder, and that's all I knew. I thought maybe somewhere down the road he might be able to help us. And so my friend said, you have to come see this property that someone wants to donate to us, which was incredible to me that somebody wanted to donate land, but I was like, I know nothing about building a home, and that scares me to death. So we came out here to look at it this June and thought we'd just kind of come out and check it off the list and, you know, we're done, we'll go home now. But when we got out here and saw what we had been given, we were truly amazed and blessed and just at peace. So I knew as soon as I got home, I needed to call this guy who has been on my list for a year. And I called him that night after trying to find his information, left a message. The next morning, I had an email saying, please call me today at 1. So I called him at 1-ish, and when I got on the phone with him, I started explaining what we were doing, And he asked me, have you ever seen the movie Taken? And I said, actually, I have. And he said, I recently saw that movie, but just the other day I told my wife that if God ever asked me to be involved in the fight against human trafficking, I couldn't say no. And I'm sitting there listening to this going, yes, knowing that he is going to be an incredible asset to our team. And he already has been in such a huge way.
So this is Brianne, and Brianne is one of our board members, and she's also one of our rebels. And I'm going to let her just share with you guys.
So the really cool thing about the Potter's Hands Foundation is it's not only one church or one group of people that's involved in this. We need as much help as we can get. Every church that wants to get involved, every individual that wants to get involved, we can use your individual gifts and your individual talents to help us bring this dream, this vision to fruition. So if you're interested in helping, you can visit thepottershandsfoundation.org or go to our Facebook page. If you're interested in being a rebel, contact us and we'll definitely get you more information about that.
So I am really excited about the role that the rebels are playing in this ministry, because there's no way we could do it without them. And there are just so many ways that people can get involved, as Brianne was saying. One other thing that I just wanted to be able to share today is that recently my husband and I met with a survivor. And when we spoke with her, she shared her story with us. And she is now 21 years old, but she grew up in a home where her mom was a heroin addict and had men coming into the home on a regular basis who repeatedly sexually abused her. And as a result, she got obviously fed up with that and ran away from home and ended up on the streets in the Buffalo area. And she was trafficked in the kind of the typical way that we think about trafficking here in the United States. She was in the back of a box truck traveling around to different locations, often servicing men at sporting events or truck stops. And she was really a mess herself. She became addicted to heroin and really struggled. She would get arrested on a pretty regular basis and ask for help, but they really didn't know what to do with her because there wasn't a place for her to go to receive the kind of help. So often they would just send her back out on the street. And so one day she really kind of had a sobering moment as she was in the back of a truck and physically had to fight her way out of that truck to be able to get free. And she found that she was in Rochester, New York, not too far from where she had been originally taken, and called her mom, who also must have had a moment of just compassion for her daughter, and she was able to get her into a rehab center in New York City. Not a home that was specifically designed for trafficking survivors, which is unfortunate because their needs are so unique and individual. That we really need to be building more homes for these girls so that they can get the help that they need. And one of the things that really kind of frustrates me a little bit is when I'm talking with people, first of all, just being able to educate them and say, yes, it is happening here, but even if it wasn't happening here, knowing that there is such a huge need in our country and knowing that we have the opportunity to do something about it should be enough motivation for us to do something. And that's what gets me motivated. I just want to be able to help. I don't care where these girls come from. If they need a home, if they need a safe place, if they need a place where they can have an identity and feel whole again, then we want to provide that. And so we just thank you for watching. We thank you for being a part of our ministry, and we look forward to meeting you soon. Thank you.
This morning, saw a world full of trouble now. I thought, how do we ever get so far down? And how's it ever gonna turn around? So I turned my eyes to heaven. I thought, God, why don't you do something? Well, I just couldn't bear the thought of people living in poverty, children sold into slavery. The thought disgusted me, so I shook my fist at heaven. I said, God, why don't you do something?